Welcome, friends. I'm very happy to be in Florida. Left Chicago in cold weather, came here. Everybody said, what a beautiful sunny place. And there were a lot of sun this morning. But then somebody said, sometimes rain is good. I said, that's very good. They used to say in great master's time that rain is also very good, because the grace of a master is compared to the falling of rain. When rain falls, water comes down, it nourishes the ground. And if somebody is thirsty and has a cup in his hand and puts it in the rain, the cup gets filled up. They compare a perfect living master's grace to the falling of rain. That if the cup of our attention is towards the master, it gets filled up. But if the cup is in a different direction, it does not get filled up. No matter how much it rains, if you place a cup in the rain upside down, it won't get filled up. It does not mean there is no rain. Rain is there, but the cup is in the wrong direction. On our spiritual path, our cup is our attention. Where is our attention? If our attention is towards the Master, the cup of the grace that is flowing from Him fills up that cup. Cup is in the other direction, worldly direction, other activities that we are doing, cup does not get filled up. If it is divided and the cup is lying on its side, a few drops may get in. And we may say there is some water, a few drops of water, but we have not fully experienced the grace of a master. So we have to remember that masters come to give us their grace. They come to give us their love. They come to take us back to our true home. If our attention is not on what they are giving us, how do we benefit from it? It does not mean that grace is not flowing. It's only that we have not turned our attention towards it. This whole existence of ours in this world or any other world is based upon where we place our attention. Wherever our attention goes, that becomes our reality. And that is why, since all our attention is on things that are happening outside, therefore this outside world is our only reality. These masters come to tell us that this is a very temporary show. What you are wearing as physical bodies is not your own self. These will go away. They will die. Every human being has died, including masters, including prophets, including saviors, saints. Nobody has been able to live forever in this garment we are wearing, which we call a human body. And yet we think that is our self. The Master tells us our self is lying inside these garments, not the garment itself. The human body is not our self. It's a temporary garment we are wearing to have a temporary experience of a physical world, because we are wearing a physical garment. If we wear a different garment, we have that experience. There is a garment known as astral garment. An astral body, which we can also wear like the physical body. The difference between an astral body and a physical body is simple. Physical body has physical matter in it. Astral body has no matter in it. It has all the sense perceptions. It can see, touch, taste, smell, do everything that the physical body can do. It has no physical matter at all. And that is why its ability to fly, ability to do many other things which we are hindered because of our physical body, it's possible with an astral body. But it's still a body. And some people call it as if it's their soul. People say, that person died and his soul has come somewhere else. Souls never travel. Only the astral body travels. The reason why I say souls never travel is because soul is experienced at a point where there is no space and time. There is no place to travel. Soul manifests itself. through a mind which creates space and time, and therefore all travel is taking place in the three worlds of the physical, astral and mental. There is no travel otherwise. It's only realization of your own self. But the soul is something so different, so beyond the mind, that we are constantly considering our astral self to be the soul. Sometimes many people have said, our mind is the soul, because they think, I can think, that is me. The thinker is me. No, the thinker is me working a mind. The mind is made to think. It's a tool given to us to think in time and space. This is also a tool. Physical body is also a tool given to us to have a physical experience. Astral body is given to us to have sensory experience. Mind is given to us to create space and time and make events and make karma and make a very different type of experience than would be possible if there was no space and time. Our soul lives immortally beyond space and time, beyond mind. We all want to reach our true home, where we belong. What does it mean to go to our true home? Where is our true home? Is it lying somewhere up in the sky? Is it lying in some foreign area? Is it lying in some other galaxy? Not at all. We are in our true home right now. Where do we have to go? But we have just lost the awareness of our true home. To gain back the awareness of your home cannot strictly be called a journey. Yet we call it a spiritual journey to our true home, as if we are very far away from it. The true home is right inside us and is always with us, wherever we are. Right now, just because we have covered ourselves with these bodies, we are not aware of our true home. When we are able to remove the awareness of our bodies, we will find our true home. So that is why it's not a journey that we have to go anywhere. We have to get the awareness of our own true home, true self, where we belong. Why should we do it? It's not necessary to do it. If you are happy enjoying the show, you don't have to do it. We came to enjoy a show. We wanted to have a different experience, different ups and downs of a physical world. We are getting it. So we don't have to go back home. But if we are unhappy, if we think this is not our place, if we feel we have had enough of it, only then we are seekers of a true home. Not everybody needs to go to a true home. So many people are living their life not even thinking about going anywhere. They say, this is our life, only life. We are born, we work hard, we raise children, we raise families, and we live our life, and then we die. And there, most people are living like that, all over the world. It's only some people who feel this is not their place, that this is not the kind of life that it belongs to us, that we are different from what we are experiencing, that we don't belong here, we have had enough of this show, what is going on, and we want to go back home. Those are called the seekers of their true home, seekers of spirituality, seekers of the truth, seekers of finding out who they really are. This spiritual path we talk of is only meant for those seekers. If you don't seek for that, you don't need it. But if you're a seeker, that depends on what you seek. Most of the seekers are only asking for an escape from a bad situation into a good situation. Many of the seekers are seeking heaven. Heaven must be a nice place, as opposed to hell, which must be a bad place. Both heaven and hell are in the astral realm. In the astral plane, both can be accessed. And anybody who has the capacity to withdraw attention from the physical world within oneself and become unaware of this body can have an experience of heaven and hell. But when we are only looking for heaven, then we are only stuck with the astral plane and no more. And some people want to go beyond. They want to know the origin. Where did we come originally from? That's our place. And they can go up to the causal region of the mind. The universal mind exists, from which all minds are participating. Their thinking process now, looks like we are all separate minds. They are all coming from the same source. And there are so many masters. I have met them. They describe that as our ultimate home. That because universal mind creates everything, the universe is speaking to us and telling us where to go. The universe is coming from there. Therefore, the top of the causal plane is our real home. And such people, with such seeking, go there. But there are some few people who realize that even a universal mind is after all a mind. It's not the soul. It's not ourself. Even the life of the mind is limited. Maybe a few million years of physical time is still limited. And those who really want to go beyond the mind are the seekers who travel not by effort, not by the mental thinking, but by a different method altogether. And they are the ones who go beyond the mind with the help of an ordinary person who comes into their life, but we call him a perfect living master. What is so special about an ordinary person, just like us, coming into our life, and we call him perfect living master? Where do these words come from? We call such a person living master because he is alive in a human form. We are not talking of somebody who's already passed away. And when we think we can talk to a past master, we believe we are talking to a master, we are talking to our own mind. Any number of tests can prove that when we talk to old masters, it's our own mind speaking back to us. We can never be sure. And the mind tells us stories that we like to hear. The mind likes to hear. Therefore, a living master is one who can tell us, no, this is not correct. He's like us, ourselves. But why call him perfect master? Because all imperfection is created by the mind. And beyond the mind is only perfection. And therefore, he operates while in a physical body from an awareness which is beyond the mind. So we call him a perfect master. So that is why only such human beings who have attained the state of awareness beyond the mind, we call them as perfect living masters. We can never find them. Because they live like us, they're ordinary people. And they have not come to show off that they are masters. They never say they are masters. They never claim to be masters. They live like us, but they find us. Since we cannot know them, they come and find us. How do they find us? Because they are operating at all levels of consciousness at the same time. They are operating from the level of oneness, where they are simultaneous with us. They are the same like us. They are one with us. And therefore, they know where we are as seekers. Therefore, they come into this play of ours and join us wherever we are in order to take us back home, because that is our seeking. So that is why these perfect living masters, ordinary people with the awareness of totality, awareness of all levels of consciousness, they are the ones we call perfect living masters. We cannot find them, but they can find us. That is why they say in India, when a chela is ready, guru appears. When a disciple is ready, a master appears. He does not say when a disciple is ready, he can find a master. He will appear. How will a master appear? He will create circumstances and coincidences by which he will appear. He will appear out of nowhere because we will think it's just an ordinary coincidence, ordinary thing happening, and suddenly he'll appear. We may not recognize him on day one. We may recognize him on day 10. But something will happen to us, which will give us a feeling that we have been waiting for that moment. Something will tell us that we are being pulled by a very subtle kind of love, and we can't explain what is pulling us. Only a little while back, to a small group, I was explaining that my master, great master, Baba Sawan Singh, he pulled so many people from all over the world. And they just came by strange coincidences. There was one man, an intellectual professor. He came to great master. You see his picture here. That's my master's picture. This professor came to this, my master, and said, Master, I am a professor of psychology and philosophy. I have studied the possibilities of the mind, and I know all the stories you make. There are astral regions and causal regions, and there is a such kind of true home can all be made up by your mind. And I know it, I have studied this subject. Therefore, I don't believe what you are telling, that you really go somewhere to a true home. This is our only home. This is our only life. Great Master said, Professor, you have a right to believe what you like. My experience is a little different from yours, but we can easily agree to disagree. The professor went away. Next week he came again. Said, Master, I have come to tell you, I don't believe any of your teachings. And these are all made up. Great Master said, I told you last week also, you have a different point of view, I have a different point of view. We can have differences in the opinion, but that doesn't matter. I don't try to convince you. You are not trying to convince me. We have different experiences. So the professor went away. Third week he came again on a weekend and said, Master, I've come to tell you, I don't believe what you tell us. Great Master said, I understand you told me two times earlier, but why are you coming to me again and again telling me the same thing? He said, I don't know why I'm pulled to you. I don't know what makes me feel I have to come and see you. I don't know what happens to me. I feel good to come and tell you that you don't know anything. The strange thing is, that man fell so much in love with the Master, was initiated and made good progress. And I had an opportunity to see that man. So that is why the pull of a perfect living Master is coming not from the mind, not from the body, not from the sense perceptions. It's coming from the soul and touching our soul. When soul contacts soul, it's a subtle feeling inside. Something is pulling us and the mind can't understand it. The mind sometimes wants to disprove. Mind says, I can't be sure. Sometimes it says, I'm afraid. There can be fear. I remember some people once came from a church and a friend of mine had invited them to come and listen to me, and they had their beads ready. They were sitting at the back, and when I started speaking, they were moving the beads, save our souls, save our souls. Maybe devil has come. This is how the mind works. And yet, the pull of a perfect living Master, of his unconditional love, is so strong that ultimately, I say ultimately because we are living in a world of time, and events happen in time, and eventually we are totally in fully love, in love with the Master. Master's love pulls us. And why is that? Because if you want to go beyond the mind, only that will work what is beyond the mind. Effort of any kind, struggle of any kind, is a mental struggle. The mind struggles. I want to work hard. Then only I can get something. The mind has been indoctrinated with this thinking, not this lifetime. For several lifetimes, we have carried the same mind with us for several lifetimes. And that mind thinks we can get nothing without effort. And even on the spiritual path, we can't get anything without effort. So when perfect living Masters come and see us, what do they come for? Have they come to teach us some system of meditation? Have they come to tell us how to reach God? Have they come to give us discourses? What do they come into our life for? Very simple answer. The true answer, they come to take us back to our true home, period. The rest is a game with the mind. They tell us, we'll go together to a true home. I've come for that purpose. And we say, what should I do for that? Okay, meditate. More meditation. Struggle. Follow these rules. The mind does not accept. If they don't say those things, we don't accept it. There has to be some method, some struggle. Our mind is so indoctrinated with that idea that we cannot do anything unless we struggle. So they give us all the methods of meditation to satisfy the mind. And the mind can make some progress with that effort. Effort can take us to a withdrawal of attention by through meditation, simple practice of dying while living, which means that you pull your awareness from outside, put it inside, you become unaware of the world, then you become unaware of your body, and you can get a higher experience. You can do that with struggle, you can do with mental effort, with meditation. You can even go higher if you learn higher techniques of meditation, which is done meditation with the inner body, with which you operate inside. So those things are possible with struggle, but they are all within the mind. Perfectly living masters come to us to take us beyond the mind, to our true home, not in mental region. The three regions, three worlds are of the mind. And that is why they have come for something for which we have a deeper seeking. And only those who have deeper seeking, they are the ones who are met by these masters by coincidence, and they are the ones that they take them back home. If somebody were told, look, you have been accepted by a perfect living master, you have to do nothing. You say, how is that possible? I have to play my role. I have to do what I have to do. That is why it's for the mental reasons that all these perfect living masters have to act like ordinary masters, have to become teachers. Teachers of meditation, teachers of yoga, any kind of yoga. Though they now say that the best yoga is Surta Shabda Yoga, which means Surta, which is attention, Shabda, the sound, yoga means union with your higher self. They use the method of using your attention to place in the sounds within. As you know, there are many sounds that are all interconnected with our ultimate sound of ourself. And even with the totality, with God Himself. God speaks through a word, which is not a spoken word, but comes out and it becomes a spoken word at this level. It was interesting for me at one time to see that in the Bible, say James' Gospel begins with the verses, "In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by Him, and nothing was made that was not made by Him." Such a profound statement about the power of a word, which was the same as God. In fact, it's described as more in the beginning. It doesn't say in the beginning there was God who was also Word. In the beginning was a Word, and the Word was God. The word has been given so much importance. A word that creates the whole universe, that nothing is created except by that word, what kind of word is it? It can't be a spoken word. But the biggest surprise came to me when I happened to read an Indian scripture, the Rig Veda, out of four Vedas, which constitutes the substance of our Indian philosophy, belief systems. The Rig Veda describes the beginning of the universe. And it says, in the beginning was a nad. Nad means sound. In the beginning was a sound. And the sound created everything that is created here. It gave precedence even to Paramatma. Even God was created later than the word. How can you talk of a word creating anything? So obviously, the meaning of that word is very different. To understand, in the Sikh scriptures, so many Sikh friends of mine, those who wear turbans and believe in the holy scripture Guru Granth Sahib, they read there, Shabde dharti, shabde akash, shabde shabad vaya prakash. The Shabd, or the word, created the earth and the sky, created everything that you can see, and created itself also. And these are strange words to talk about a word, sound, creating all these things. What does it all mean? One has to go to different levels of awareness to understand the meaning. When we are in physical world, in physical bodies, our spoken word is the word. If nobody ever tells us about a spiritual path, nobody tells us anything about perfect masters, which are spoken words, we never know anything. So the spoken word counts in the physical world. It's still a word. But when we are able to meditate and go within, we are still using spoken words to go within in order to control the mind by use of what we call mantras, simran, zikr. What is all that? Repetition, prayer. All prayers, all mantras, all repetition, all zikr is everything, is words. We are using spoken words, but not speaking with the tongue, speaking with the mind. Now the words have changed slightly, that from the tongue speaking it, now the mind is speaking it. Then what happens? Those who have done that, if they hold their mind steady in their head by the spoken word, which is now being repeated by the mind, another sounds can come which are not words. They are like music. And we can hear an inner music in our head. We all have it. It's a different kind of sound inside. There's one most melodious sound like a loud bell ringing, but without the hit of it, the peal of it. It's a strange kind of sound. All have it. By holding your attention, with the mind speaking those words, you get that sound. And the sound is directly connected with those words. So you realize that the spoken word, which became a mental word, is now become a sound. It's still the word. If you go further, are able to ascend the astral state of consciousness, go to the mental causal state of consciousness, you will find that the sound is there continuously. Not only is it continuous, you feel you have been hearing it all the time. That you have not started hearing when you go there. It's a very strange experience that you hear a sound and you find out it's the same sound, same word, just at a higher level of consciousness. That sound has been sometimes called anhad shabd, no boundaries, because you feel experience. It's not just statement. You feel you have been hearing it all the time. The earlier sound, the earlier music has been called dhunatmak. That means in the form of a sound that can be listened, but not words. Speak spoken words, dhunatmak musical words, then unending words, and then what happens? You go beyond and you find the word is our atma and ourself. It has the same consciousness. We were the word. And it's called sar shabd. That means it's the real word. That means we found our own identity. Our own identity was speaking, which became spoken words here. Yes, our own self. We can go further higher up and find its our own totality. Not only that, the most important thing is, this is all connected all the time while we are here and we are living. Our conscious state as a physical being is connected continuously, because that word or that creative power can be heard today in this physical body like a sound, like a word. Therefore it has been said that the beginning has been made by the word, and the word was there in the beginning. Word was God, word was everything. Word is everything in that sense, because we can speak it here, we can hear it here. And then why is it called audible life stream? It's life itself which we have. Is audible. When something is audible, we call it a word or a sound. So that is why it's a very important gospel of John's, where he describes how the word has created everything. So that is why we are very, very lucky that we can start having an experience with a human being, just like ourselves. And his spoken words are the beginning. But the spoken words are coming not from here, not from one higher space, not from the next higher place, but from the highest. In our life, we live one reality at one time. Currently, we are all sitting here in this hall, and we are all feeling the world is fine, golfers are golfing outside, rain is coming outside, nice great world is here, and this is our reality. This is not only our reality, this is the only reality. We have no other reality. When we go to sleep and we have a dream, the dream state looks like real. We don't know where we are sleeping. When we are dreaming, we think the dream body is our reality and we forget the wakeful reality. Dream reality becomes our only reality. We wake up, dream becomes unreal. It does not become unreal till we wake up. Some people say that we remembered in our dream, it was a dream. And we said to our friends there, you know, it's a dream. And the friend said, who is dreaming? Are we all dreaming or only one is dreaming? He said, maybe I don't know that, but we might be all dreaming, but it's a dream. And then the person woke up and found neither the friends were real, nor that dream was real. It was just an experience of one person, one dreamer. But the reality changed. When we withdraw our attention from this physical body and go to a higher level of awareness, which is called astral level, the physical level disappears like a dream. And we wake up to a higher reality. That becomes the only reality. This becomes unreal. We go to still higher reality, the two lower realities disappear. We are so used to a single reality that no matter how high we go, we are always holding on to one reality, except when we go to the top, where you discover all the realities were created from one source. They're just different experiences at different sources, different creations, creations of experiences, different sources. Perfect living masters not only come from that reality, they hold that reality while they're walking amongst us and talking to us. Therefore, they are using all levels of awareness, all realities at the same time. We, as practitioners of meditation, we go step by step and we have only one step as our knowledge at one time. They have all the steps at the same time while they are sitting amongst us, talking to us. So that is why when they talk not from scriptures. They talk not from what they've read or heard. They talk from what they are experiencing right now at that time. So that is why their talk affects us. And sometimes we feel they know us better than we know ourselves. Why is that? Because in truth they do. In truth they are operating from that level. So that is why it's so different. A perfect living master is described as one who already is in that state where he wants to take us, because we are at this time confined to one reality. They take us to a total knowledge of all realities. This is a very big thing. But very few people are really interested in that or seeking that. Therefore, what you seek, the masters come for that. So there are several levels of masters who come into our life. Not only that, for a particular individual, a particular master will come to take him where he has to go. A particular individual may have a higher level of seeking, but not understand his own seeking, and may accept smaller things. And masters will come, teach those smaller things, and the seeking will still continue. Another master will come in their life. A third master can come in their life. A third master may come in this life, if there is time, or in the next life. The spiritual course we are talking about, which takes us to our true home, is not based on one life. It presumes that our seeking has gone on for a long time, even before we were born here. There are so many small children that come and they are seekers of the ultimate truth at that young age. There was no way they could be made seekers at that age. They are carrying all the seeking of past lives. So that is why it's a long-term course. When we go before a perfect living master and he looks at us, we think he's looking at our eyes or looking at our body. He is looking at our entire past. He is looking at several previous lifetimes. And we are just spending a few minutes with the perfect master. He's seeing everything that has brought us to that point. So he realizes what is needed for that person. That is why, unlike other teachers who teach the same course, same meditation to everybody, the perfect living masters customize the teaching for each individual according to what they need at that time. We are not all at the same level. We don't all have the same experiences. We don't have the same destinies. Therefore, the perfect living masters customize what they give us according to what we need at that time. They may say, at this time, you need to be meditating more. And later they may say, no, you can give up meditation. Just live with your love and devotion, which is already grown in you. Same answer they may give to different people or give different answers. So, in the case of perfect living masters, they don't have any general philosophy they are sharing with us. They are sharing something individually suited for us. And that is why it's very important to be close to them and to know them as human beings, as friends. And I can tell you, from my experience with my master, a perfect living master is the best friend we can have. In fact, there was a great disciple of great master, and his name was Dr. Ishwar Singh, a veterinary guy whose stories I sometimes tell. And before he died, he said, I have discovered the truth. A perfect living master is a friend first and master afterwards. That is why if there is no feeling of friendship with the master, then we are converting our spiritual seeking into a religion. What's the difference? Religion, we just believe in something. Somebody has said, mostly long time ago, we're just believing it because other people are repeating it, we are believing it. There's no friendship involved in that with the master. There's no personal contact with that. Sheikh Farid was a perfect master, but his own master was Sheikh Qutbuddin. And when Sheikh Qutbuddin was alive and was master of Farid, Farid told his son, son, it's a great opportunity. Qutbuddin is alive and you go and get initiation from him, get blessings from him, so that you will also get the fruits of that blessing. And the son, like most sons, grown up young people, said, master, I still have my life to live, you know. Father, I'll go when I'm a little older. You know, you are old, that is your time now to meditate. Let me live my life. Suddenly, Qutbuddin died. And the son realized that Qutbuddin was dead. So he ran to the grave of Qutbuddin, where his body was lying before burial. He shaved his head, which was customary at that time, and placed his head on the feet of the dead Qutbuddin. And Sheikh Farid is standing next to him. And he says, son, this is the body of a person whom I worshipped and loved, like I have loved nobody else. And yet I tell you, you are getting nothing out of it. It's just a piece of flesh, dead flesh. Master's gone. Even 1 second is too late. That is why he said, I told you, Qutbuddin is old. You please get the best advantage right now. You come too late. Of course, Qutbuddin then named Farid to carry on his work, and the son got initiated from the father later on. But I'm only telling you the importance. Qutbuddin gave everything to Farid. And Farid said, son, unless you can hold the hand of a Murshid-e-Kamil, perfect master, you get nothing. If you are just having a distant worshipper, it's just like worshipping in a religion. Worshipping an unseen God. But this difference here is a person who is in touch with God 24/7. He's available here in this physical world. If you can't hold his hand, whose hand will you hold in order to go to God? So that is why it's so important that when we are real seekers, seeking in our hearts, don't have to shout out aloud. No loud prayers are needed to find the true God, our Creator. What we need is a silent prayer inside, silent seeking inside our own hearts. I want to go back to my true home. A perfect living master will appear in our life. It's a natural system. Who arranged it? Our own totality arranged it when we were part of the same totality. It's not somebody else. Whatever I'm speaking of is all within ourselves, not outside. Outside is creation, not the creator. The Creator is always in sight. And that is why it's such a great opportunity for us that we still are living in an age where, in spite of all the distractions created by not only the worldly temptations and so on, but even by religious distractions, which take us into blind faith and blind beliefs, we still have the opportunity to seek within our hearts and perfect living masters appear in our life and guide us to our true home. There is no scope for blind faith for true seekers. They want to seek and see with their own eyes. They want to have experiences, personal experiences, not because somebody else had an experience and we are believing on that. Personal experience. My master was very strong on that point, that there is no scope on true spirituality for any blind faith. And what is blind faith? Somebody said something and we believe it. Without any verification, without any further progress, it remains a dead belief. A living faith grows like living things grow. Every experience, every day's experience makes the faith grow. That's living faith, not dead faith, not blind faith. When you are in the company of a perfect living masters, you will notice every day something is happening, inside and outside, which is increasing your faith. That faith is acceptable on the spiritual path. So that is why I am sharing these things with you, because I had a great privilege to spend so much time with the perfect living masters. In a few days, I'll turn 91. It's an old age, reasonably old age, and I was initiated by the great master almost 81 years ago. 81 years of testing out something is a pretty long time. And I am speaking from those tests. I'm not speaking from any book or anything. In fact, till I came to the United States, I'd never read any spiritual book at all. But I had to read it here, because people asked me questions. The very first thing which brought me in the beginning, in the 60s when I first time came to this country, I told a small group of people who were meditating. I said, "How are you meditating? We have a very nice place. We have built a nice place for meditation. And we all have got our nice cushions on which we sit, or nice chairs on which we sit. And then we close our eyes and we remember the Lord and we do meditation and prayer." So I said, "If you buy a special chair for meditation, is it not likely that you are meditating on the chair and not on God? Because the chair is so valuable to you. Attention is on the chair on which you are sitting, or a special cushion you bought, or a carpet you bought, a rug you bought." And so many people told me that's what they do. And I said, "But my master told me that none of these places are suitable for meditation. Some people, some of my friends, I visited their home, set apart a small part of the room or one full room. This is our temple. This is our prayer room. This is a place of worship we have made in our own house, decorated it. Candles, and nice scenting of those little things that come with smoke and gives essences and whatnot. Very beautiful places they arranged to meditate there." And when I told them, they got angry with me that we made such beautiful places for meditation and you are saying they are not good for meditation because they draw your attention to the place. And I said, "Great Master said, real meditation, effective meditation, can take place only if you first sit behind the eyes at the third eye center. If you haven't sat there, you shouldn't start meditation at all. That's the place to meditate and not anywhere outside." They were surprised. "Why hasn't he written the books? We have never read anything like that." I said, "I also haven't read anything like that, but do you have any books containing great master teachings?" "Yes, we have a book called Spiritual Gems, letters written by great master, your master, to American disciples." I said, "May I have a copy of it?" I took a copy of the book and read it all night and marked 16 places in that book where the great master said exactly the same thing. You should not even start your meditation till you are first sat down at the third eye center behind the eyes. That's the only place good for starting meditation. So then I began to read books which gave the same thing that I had been hearing. People don't read. Can you imagine when we read a book? What do we get out of the book? What do we already know? Oh yes, I understand that. I knew it. Sometimes some new stories are coming up. Next time we read the book, oh, there's something new in it. It's the same book. I was at Harvard University in Cambridge, and a friend of mine came to me. He said, somebody gave me a book by Julian Johnson, an old American surgeon who went and became a disciple of your master. It's called Path of the Masters. He said, useless book. It's all based upon the very strange ideas of the Indian gurus and so on, and does not really deal with practical problems of meditation and life. And he said, I threw away the book. I said, all right, I haven't read those books, so I don't know much, but I'm glad that you at least studied the book. 6 months later, he comes to me, I found the truth. And I know what to do with it. I found that the perfect living master is the one who gave us the truth. I said, how did you find out? He said, from a book called The Path of the Master. I said, is it the same book that you threw away? He said, not only the same book, same copy of the book. I just found out. I had thrown it away. Now the book made sense. Our state of readiness makes all the difference. We, 20 people, go to hear the master's message and to come back and discuss what did the master say, 20 different things. They all hear what they have to hear, what they need to hear, what they want to hear very often. And masters often say things what we want to hear. We feel happy. And if they don't say things that we want to hear, we won't go next time to hear them. They're just a padding on the real message. There are so many of these little experiences I can share with you in dealing with masters, that I've spent time with masters. So that is why masters can give different answers. Once a man came with his young daughter to the master. He said, Master, my daughter has grown up and the family says we should marry her now. She says she wants to go to college and study more. What should we do? Master said, what's the difference between boys and girls? If boys can go to college, she should also go to college. Send her to college. Thank you, the parent said. Girl was very happy and they left. 10 minutes later, another father comes with his grown-up girl and he says, Master, the girl has grown up and her family says we should marry her and she wants to go to college. Identical situation. Great Master said, what have girls to do with college? They have to raise kids, they have to raise their family. Marry her so she can raise her family. Two different answers given within 10 minutes in identical situations. We can't understand. The masters, when they see, they can see the whole pattern of our karma, pattern of our events of life, and they advise accordingly. So that is why we cannot judge these masters at all, how they operate, because they have not come to become teachers. They come to take us home. And that's why their method is a little different from those of teachers. They become teachers for the sake of our minds. Our minds want to be taught, they teach. Our minds want to struggle, they allow us to struggle. Our mind wants to find a method, they give us a method. They do all those things so because we have to overcome the mind. And for overcoming our mind, they give us all those methods. And all the time, they have a little chuckle in their mouth. Look, this person doesn't know. I'm going to take him to a true home anyway because I've accepted. I promised. A perfect living master's promise comes at the time of initiation. When they accept you. Okay, I accept you. It's a done deal. But we can't believe it, so they make us go through a process of taking us back home. But the assurance is given even at that time. I am sharing all these things with you because I know you are seekers. That's why you are here. And I am sharing them from my experiences, and not from books. People cannot judge a master unless he delivers what he says. And I was myself very skeptical, one of the great skeptics. I was very skeptical when I was young. And I wanted to be sure that the things that are being said can be proven. Now, most of the people, when they say proof, they say empirical proof, proof outside. And here we get proof inside. So some of them remain outside and they don't want to go inside because the proof is not outside, but it's inside yourself. You get experience inside and life outside changes. Events start happening in your life. You are experiencing it. It's not a public display of what you are getting. And that is why some people don't accept it as proof. Our idea of proof has been so much linked with an experience that we are having outside. And these experiences that come genuinely to us are happening inside. I was studying in good university, Harvard University, very good university. And they were professors of psychology, especially two professors who would argue a lot because they were experimenting with mushrooms and drugs, and LSD and DMT had come at that time. Dr. Richard Alpert, Dr. Timothy Leary. And they would, in the beginning, before they got into their studies, were discussing whether these alternate states of consciousness, there we can experience we are different, we are somewhere else, we are not what we think we are. Can they not be created by the mind? And some other professors joined them too, especially psychology department. And they would argue with me. They said, all that you are talking of can be generated by the mind. I said, I accept it. Possibly it is true. Why should I deny it? If the mind can generate all this experience, it's great. He said, then why are you calling it reality and that's a real experience? I said, because in comparison to the experience here, it looks more real. But supposing it's not real, let me accept your point of view that suggestion can create these experiences. I am using auto-suggestion to create these experiences. But what is the effect? I am happy 24/7 because of an auto-suggested experience. And you people are taking Prozac, antidepressant. Is that not true? They were taking antidepressants actually in depression. The more they thought of their condition, the more depressed they got. So I said, is it not a good solution that we should all teach auto-suggestion to people by which they can create these experiences and be happy? Ultimately, everybody wants to be happy. They try to escape unhappiness. So even if I agreed with them, it still makes sense to practice something, to get something which is giving us happiness. I remember the kind of discussions we had. Of course, they learnt a lot about it. Richard Alpert went to India and he became a disciple of a guru there, and I remember that. And he changed his name, guru changed his name to Ram Das. And he wrote books as Ram Das, describing his spiritual experiences which were not related to drugs. He gave the examples of the drugs he was taking and the experiences that came from meditation. He recorded. Timothy Leary went to the Pacific on an island and he set up a church. And church, the name was Church of the Boo-Hoo. And the whole idea that he expounded was, there is no difference between the divine and the stupid thing that we, between the sublime and the ridiculous, no difference. So he named that church. But these people took a long time to understand the value of what is lying inside us. Everything is lying inside us. There is no outside to go anywhere. This is the real church, the real temple, the real mosque, the real synagogue. It does not matter what religion you believe in. You don't have to change your religion. Accept all the rituals of your religion. Just experiment going within your own self to find what religion was saying is true or not. make a dead belief into a living faith just by going within yourself. And this going within yourself is facilitated when the outside distractions, outside attachments are reduced by the love that a perfect living master provides, which shifts our attention from outside attachments to the attachment that grows within our own hearts for a master. It's helpful. So that is why I am so glad to share these things with you. You are all very blessed. You are all on the right path. Because seeking is the right path, you are all seekers. And you will all get the chance to get enlightenment in a real way, which means within yourself, you'll find out who you are. Once you find out who you are, you'll also find out who your Creator is. Because the Creator and you are no separate inside you. Thank you very much for very patient listening. And I'm very glad that I got a chance to see you. And there's going to be a little break here now. And I'll come for a little while after the break and answer any questions if you have. If you're given any written questions, I'll be able to take them up. Or any personal interviews, if any one of you have asked for a one-on-one meeting, I'll be very happy to meet you. And thank you very much for very patiently listening to my stories.